first best practices has to do with using IT to save IT. Most operators lack the visibility into their data center infrastructure that they have as they have in their data center IT equipment. And we can't manage what we don't measure. So if we had the same level of monitoring that our operators have on the IT side, we would be able to measure and track performance, and that would lead us to being able to spot problems before they result in high energy costs or downtime. So along these lines, LBL has deployed a wireless monitoring system produced by SynapSense. It's a 700-point system that measures temperature, humidity, underfloor pressure, and current, as well as other. I mean, that's what we're doing now. It can monitor just about anything if you want it to. Okay, so our visualization is improving, and this is an example of an animation based on those 700 sensors where we're seeing a cold aisle become hot because we didn't do things quite right in an implementation of some curtains. So a problem was identified. And then we started to make corrective actions, and the cold aisle cooled down to where it was supposed to be.
So Dale, if I could just ask you, this is not a model, this is actual data.
This is actual data. It looks sort of like a CFD model, but this is the real McCoy. We were like everybody else. Hot spot starts to form, time to put in a new crack unit, right? So we were solving the problem, and we were solving the symptoms and not the problem, but things have changed. Anyway, our air management effort has included doing an assessment following the DOE Save Energy Now assessment protocols. We perform CFD modeling, we've deployed the wireless sensor network, and by doing those things, we've identified a number of improvements that I'm gonna kind of go through. And each one of these I'll mention has been facilitated by the monitoring system that was installed, because we can kind of track the improvements and then make sure that they stay in place and really get a good sense of what's going on. So here's an example of where there was a 12-inch blanking plate missing. It was added back in or added in, and the temperature dropped 20 degrees. Our floor tiles had gotten totally out of tune. So there was way more permeable floor tiles than we should have had. You know, again, this is one of those things that, you know, stuff happens. There seems like a need for cooling, so you make the tiles more permeable, and after a while, that has a negative effect. So with the monitoring system, Dave was able to optimize the floor tile situation, and that increased the underfloor pressure. That's the graphs on the upper right, and decreased the rack top temperature, the chart on the lower right, and effectively increase the capacity of our air handlers. So the measurement and visualization definitely assisted in the tuning of the floor tiles. So this is sort of some shots of our liquid-based cooling system. The infrastructure was installed in 2008 so that we could cool either with tower water or with chilled water. Actually, it's set up in series, so if the tower water's not cool enough, we just have to top it off with the chilled water, not a substitute. So we'll always be using tower water as the primary coolant, but if needed, we can use chilled water if we have to. Right now, we've got the rear door cooling systems installed. They're running only on tower water, and they're doing quite a good job. SynapSense is gonna be installing BTU meters on that system. So the next time I report to you, I'll be able to tell you exactly how much energy they're saving or how much of the cooling they're taking care of. Improving humidity control is the next best practice. We shouldn't need humidity control in Bay Area environments. Computer loads are only sensible. We should use the ASHRAE allowable relative humidity. In fact, many manufacturers allow even wider humidity ranges, so we need to check that out. And by eliminating or reducing or expanding the humidity range, we can eliminate equipment fighting, which is a big problem. So this is some data from our center. Out of 6 CRAC units, 3 were cooling only, 2 were cooling and humidifying, and 1 was cooling and dehumidifying. So as you can see, units were fighting one another. Our solution, disconnect all the humidification controls completely. The impact, a 3% reduction in humidity, which was completely tolerable, and a 28% reduction in crack power. So we want to improve design and operations processes, getting the IT and facilities people working together, using lifecycle total cost of ownership analysis, documenting design intent. Not in our data center, but in other data centers, I've experienced operators putting perforated tiles in the hot aisle because they thought it was getting too hot. So it's really important that the operators understand what the intent is so that they don't make a foolish mistake. I mean, they're trying to do the right thing. They just need to know what the right thing is. Eat your spinach. This is a word coined by our operating team, and that means blanking panels, taking care of leaks, maintaining your crack units, doing things that we all say we know we need to do, but a lot of times slip through the cracks because there's other priorities. Recommissioning on a regular basis as part of maintenance, and then keeping an eye on new technologies. So our next steps with SynapSense is to integrate the monitoring system with controls, because we can watch this stuff, but we can't turn cracks off. And because of that, we leave probably more cracks on than we need, causing them to run less efficiently. Implementing that live imaging system, that was the thing that looked like a CFD model, but was really real life. Installing real-time DCIE monitoring, so we'll be able to actually see any time we make a change what the impact is, and then retrofitting the crack units, Casey mentioned this, with VAV.